Bien, bonsoir. I discovered Bernie Krause 4 years and a half ago, I think, in the spring of 2012, through a page in Nature, in the scientific journal Nature, that was devoted to, I think the title was A Soundscape Explorer. And Bernie Krause revealed his work, what he was doing, and I was stunned. I found it fascinating. It was like a new world. And I went to hear and to read. It was a year where your book, The Great Animal Orchestra, was published in the States. And it's true, as you have heard, it's extraordinary because this diversity and this complementarity of all the animal voices, of all the earth voices in the air, on the ground, in the ocean, is something which is really very, very strange and very striking. And it suggests or it shows what we can hear when we don't look, when we don't see. And when we see and listen, we don't hear. And if we close our eyes, we discover a world. And it from the beginning, it evoked for me a book by a theologian, which is called John Hall, Touching the Rock, An Experience of Blindness, that Oliver Sacks mentioned in his book, The Mind's Eye. And John Hall became lost view, lost vision when he was 40, 45 or 50 years old. And he lost, after a few months, the capacity not only to see, but to imagine things through vision, what Oliver Sacks called his inner eye. And he said when this happened to him that it was an extraordinary experience, that the world began to be full. And he speaks about the colors of sounds and how the rain is painting the landscape around him in colors of soundscape. And so I think, once again, listening without seeing is something which allows us to discover hidden dimensions of the world. But what you are doing is science. And we can see it downstairs with the sonograms, which record all the voices of the animals and of the landscape. And you invented the concept of acoustic niche, the animals which are lodged not in a visible space, but in a sound space. Mm-hmm. You invented the concept of soundscape ecosystem, soundscape ecology. So it's a deep ecological experience. But it's also, Hervé alluded to it, it's also art. And it also evokes what happened in the antiquity, during the Renaissance, the Quattrocento, where art and science were considered as two aspects of a same enterprise. And there is we always think that for an art piece to be an art piece, there should be an artist that is sculpting it or painting it or composing it. And in China, that there exists something which is very beautiful, which is called dream stones. And it's part of rocks that people go looking for it in the mountains. They cut it, and if there is something magnificent, a magnificent landscape, it's considered as an artwork. And the artist, the one which discovered the rock, sign it with his name. And so your soundscapes are like these landscapes. You bring them from the natural world, and I think it's something interesting. Messiaen, Olivier Messiaen, the composer, tried to translate in music the sounds of birds. He made a lot of pieces and opera about the sound of birds. And you do something which is very different. You don't allow us to listen just to birds or to voles or to insects, but to the symphony. And it's a symphony with no composer, no conductor. It's a symphony which self-organizes, which is an emerging process. So in I was speaking of China. In Japan, some people are considered as national monuments. So for me, you are an international or planetary monument.
Thank you.
Because you are both a scientist and an artist, and because, which is very rare, scientists, there are quite a few scientists which make art. There are very few artists that become scientists. Mm. And so what you did is very original. You began as an artist, as a musician, and you become a scientist. And because it's very, very rare and original, maybe you could tell us about Bernie Krause, the musician, the beginnings.
Wow. Well, thank you. You're very kind. Before I get started, though, I want to thank Hervé Chantez and Thomas Delamar and the people at Fondation Cartier who have contributed so much to this work. They brought to life an idea that I started many years ago. And they finally brought it to life in a museum in a situation like this, which is probably the best example I've ever seen of a combination of soundscapes and art. This whole piece started about 20 years ago. And when Hervé Chantez and Thomas Delamar and I began to consider which soundscapes were going to be best represented as sound sculptures. And I sent 16 examples for them to consider, out of which 7 would be selected. And in the end, we picked two from sites in the Amazon, another from the Tsangasanga rainforest in the Central African Republic. And 2 came from American temperate regions like Algonquin Park in Ontario, Canada, Crescent Meadow located in Sequoia National Park just south of Yosemite. And there was also a subarctic region in Alaska called the Yukon Delta, dry temperate rainforest in Zimbabwe, and finally, one representing the Eastern Pacific Ocean, and it's a collage. And we made these choices because they tended to be more robust and dramatic in the setting of an exhibit. One of the things that I want to point out is some of the things that we rejected when we were considering these exhibits. And the first that I want to point out is Chernobyl here. And Chernobyl was a site of the 1986 nuclear explosion in Ukraine. And it was dead quiet till around 1990. And then scientists began to notice some changes in this site. Vegetation began to regenerate. And little by little, a surprising amount of wildlife began to return to that area. And it was expressed through its collective voice, the biophony. And it includes insects, amphibians, birds, and even mammals. Humans were forbidden to live there, and they still are. But miraculously, the biophony has returned to a level thought to be impossible for many generations at the time of this recording. And the recording is made by a colleague of mine, Peter Kuzak, from the UK. And he got permission to visit and record in the springtime of 2006. And this is what he got. Just keep in mind that even though the sounds are hopeful on the surface, Chernobyl is compromised now. And we have no idea what the outcome will be for sure. And not only is this environment, but others have changed as well. And we don't know what the outcomes will be. That's a cuckoo, by the way. Mm-hmm. Well, that's encouraging. And if we leave things alone, sometimes they just return to something like normal. But we don't know what's going to happen in the long term, unfortunately. Until after the turn of the millennium, no one had ever thought to record biophonies in the Galapagos Islands. In 2004, my wife Kat and I went to the Galapagos, and momentarily avoiding tourists, I was able to capture a fair representation of a baseline soundscape from various islands. In the Scalesia forest of Santa Cruz Island, I captured four different kinds of finches one afternoon: warbler finches, small and large tree finches, and woodpecker finches. And this is the soundscape that Darwin would have heard exactly 181 years ago in 1835, his initial visit. Oops. Okay. Sorry about that. I don't know why these aren't playing. Yes. Gray Ranch is located in the panhandle of New Mexico, and when I recorded there 24 years ago, it was a nature conservancy site. And it's, if you can imagine, a big ranch in America. This one is 3,100 square kilometers. I'm sorry, 1,300 square kilometers in size. And it's the transition biome between the Sonoran and Chihuahuan deserts, the Sonoran in the north and the Chihuahuan coming up from Mexico in the south. And since the early 16th century and the Spanish invasion, it has been pretty badly compromised by overgrazing and bad conservation practices. Beginning in the early 20th century, the area became unproductive and cattle grazing diminished, giving the land a chance to restore itself. And by 1992, when a colleague of mine and I got there, there was hardly any livestock to be seen. And because the land was returning to a healthier condition with serious constraints on the numbers of domestic livestock, the biophony, like Chernobyl, has begun to return, to a surprising degree, really. Because the southern boundary of the ranch lies on the Mexican border, part of the reason for the recovery of this particular habitat has been the free flow of wildlife back and forth across that border in both directions. These include six species of cats, like the jaguar rundi, the ocelot, and these are animals that live nowhere else. There's also a rare species of bison and the Mexican gray wolf that will be impacted, as well as insects, birds, and mammals and reptiles. And what I mean by impacted, if Donald Trump closes off that wildlife access with his proposed barrier, much of that recovery will revert to an arid, unpopulated range again. And all that unique wildlife will be lost, and this recording will be the only evidence of a time when this habitat had a chance to stabilize. This is Gray Ranch. Those are coyotes, early in the morning. Thank you. And you notice how all the animals fit in this niche right here. These are the coyotes down in this niche. Insects up here that you're hearing. More insects up here. Insects here and here. They each form their own niches, each species. And this down here is an owl. It's a great horned owl, ibu, coming up. She has its own niche, too. This stays out of the way of that guy. Here comes the owl again. Yeah. Another site that we considered was Karasoki. That's the late Diane Fossey's research station established high in the Virunga Mountains of western Rwanda, at around 2,500 meters. It had never been recorded before I went there in 1987, another one of these places that just has been overlooked in terms of sound. But I went there on a National Geographic Magnum expedition. The adventure provided an opportunity for me to live and work amongst the mountain gorillas. These are gorillas that Fossey had habituated and that she so loved. This picture was taken by Nick Nichols, a National Geographic photographer, just after the group had awakened from its afternoon siesta, which I had joined. In other words, I just lay down and slept with a group of gorillas after lunch, and I'm still here. You can see the mics mounted on the top of my head here and the cables running in back of me. That's because the gorillas like to grab anything that they can get a hold of that they're unfamiliar with, just to see what it feels like tactily. But what happened as a result of that was I was able to get some really close-up recordings. And this is what that moment sounded like. Believe it or not, these are friendly sounds. By the way, it's an elephant, a forest elephant. And all the gorillas scattered after that because the elephant frightened them. One of the things that we brought to this particular exhibit is the connection between the great animal orchestra and the influence of this animal orchestra on human music in particular. But it's not only human music, it's also music and literature and natural history and biology, but also religion as well, because when we heard those sounds in the forest at night, they became spirits to us because we couldn't see the origins of the sound. And we learned our religion in that way. But you can see here in this particular one, this is a short example of a recording from the Bayaka, the Babenzele Pygmies, who live in the Central African Republic, a place called the Zanga-Sanga Rainforest. And in 1984, I first met Louis Sarno, a young American from New Jersey who had heard anthropologist Colin Turnbull's recordings of the Babenzele Pygmies. Captivated by what he heard in these recordings, he sold everything he had and bought a one-way ticket to Bangui, which is not something I would do, but he did. And he spent the last 32 years living with this group deep in the Zanga-Sanga rainforest. recording his own versions of their songs and habitats, and he's got some of the most remarkable recordings I've ever heard, which are now archived in part at Oxford University, and also we have half of that archive. About 10 years after his arrival, he realized independently that the Bayaka were performing their songs and dances inspired by the natural soundscapes around them. In other words, they were using the sounds of the forest as a natural karaoke orchestra with which they performed, which is pretty remarkable as a concept. And the extraordinary music of the Babenzele Pygmies, his book, shows that just exactly how this works from his perspective. And this is a spectrogram that illustrates not only the acoustic niche hypothesis. You can see the insects here on this line, insects here again. There are birds here in this niche, frogs again here in this niche right here. And it's a beautiful layout of how these sounds are formed in the forest when it's a healthy habitat. And down here on the bottom are women singing. They're actually hunting for mushrooms. And you hear them off in the distance, this echoey song in the forest. And you can see, but what they've done is they've found this niche for their voices to be heard. Here they are. The Great Animal Orchestra idea at this particular place, the Fondation Cartier, is, like I said earlier on, is one of the most extraordinary examples of an expression of this kind of work, both the science and the art. What makes it particularly special is that it's the first exhibit of its kind that is sound-led. I've done 50 exhibits in museums and aquaria around the world, and all of the sound that's been used, the arcane concepts, older concepts and models that have been used in museums and aquaria and zoos and other public spaces, has always used sound as kind of a secondary prop, kind of background music, elevator music, to support visual concepts. And that's not the way it works here. Everything that's engaged in this particular work of art, this piece behind me, all of the work throughout the museum, is a reflection of the soundscape idea and sound and how important it is. And for this installation, I have nothing but praise and thanks for the people like Hervé Chandez and Thomas de Lamar and the rest of the people who worked on this, because it's really, truly an extraordinary work. And now I'm going to turn this over to Jean-Claude, who has much more to say about it.
So you don't want to speak about the beginning, about the first Bernie Krauss.
You want to torture me, don't you?
So one, the you know. What you show about Chernobyl is both beautiful and frightening, right? Because
yeah.
What it suggests is that if we render part of the world inhospitable for humans, it's good for nature and for living beings, right? And the question is, can we do it without making it poisonous? And Edward Wilson, the great sociobiologist, wrote this summer a book, which is called Half of the Earth, and where he proposed that the only way to allow the living world not to stay as it is, because as languages, I mean, on a longer time scale, species change, animals change, plants change, but to allow the evolution the persistence of life and of animal life, that we should give half the land and half the oceans to the animal and live on the other half. Yeah. And he says it could be done, which means it would not hurt us. It could be something that we could do. There were two questions that I wanted to ask you. The first one is, what do you think about this idea, which means really preserving it? And the second is, in the other half of the world where we would live, how do we interact with the natural world, with animals, with plants, with bees, with insects, knowing that it's not a place which is just for them, but it's a place where we coexist? So it's two ways of interacting with nature. One, to give space to the animals, and the other is how to live with nature in our cities, in our countries.
Yeah. You know, I don't know the answer to that. From my perspective, I've heard the changes in Chernobyl for sure, and also the changes in this habitat that I just played from the American Southwest desert. But the problem is that we don't know what the long-term effects of this is going to be. We have no idea. For instance, how the animals are going to evolve generation to generation in Chernobyl without being affected by the terribly high levels of radiation that exist in that habitat. What happens when Trump builds the wall, which he's threatening to do in Mexico? I mean, this is a terrible issue. Normally, soundscape ecology has avoided political discussion and discourse because it's non-political. It's one of those things where you either hear it or you don't. And one of the problems that I have is I have a huge archive of natural soundscapes that I've been recording now for almost 50 years. And well over 50% of my archive comes from habitats that no longer exist. We can't hear them anymore. They're either altogether silent or they've been changed so radically that we can't hear them in any of their original form. This past summer, a year ago, where I live in Northern California, about 80 kilometers north of San Francisco, I've been recording at this habitat now for 20 years since my wife Kat and I moved there. And the problem with that habitat is last year, because of the drought and because of global warming, which is hardly ever mentioned in my country in America, because of the drought that's the most severe in over 1,200 years, there was absolutely no bird song. If you can imagine what a spring is like without bird singing. Well, I heard it for the first time and I actually have it recorded. It was dead silent. There were birds, there were lots of birds, but none of them were singing. And if you can imagine a spring and early summer like that and to have to endure that as a soundscape ecologist and a person who loves to hear these sounds, it was pretty extraordinary. And I have a piece that sometimes I show, which is an 11-year spread starting in 2004, again, another recording in 2009, 2014 when the drought began to hit, and 2015 when there was nothing. And it really makes an impact on you spiritually and emotionally and certainly in terms of science. It's been published, this paper has been peer-reviewed and published everywhere. But it really makes a big difference, our effect on the natural world. And how we're going to deal with that is something I'm not quite sure. Originally, I had the idea that if we just leave things the hell alone, they're going to be able to regenerate and come back. And I still think largely that's the key. But we have to stay away from these places. We have to stop transforming them. We have a wonderful national park system that now is under threat of being completely privatized. And I think we have to pay some attention to ways in which that'll be affected. And, you know, I'm just out here to give people a sense of what has been, because I have a lot of before and after examples, and four of them you can see downstairs in the exhibit. And I'm sure a lot more of the habitats that I've not gone back to express exactly the same thing, because I do have really great baseline material for places all over the world, not only coral reefs in the ocean, but also places that range from the Arctic to the Antarctic. So this is something we got to think about. The uncertainty is clear from my perspective, and that's the kind of the subject of this evening.
The night of uncertainty, right?
Yeah. Sure.
What you said about the new president elect in the United States, more than the direct impact that, for example, a wall would, I mean, it would be a major impact on human circulation, but what it would have on the world. One of the things which is worrying is the, and it's not only him and not only there, it's a diminishing value of rationality. So it's a diminishing value of science, of deliberation, and more thinking that anything that you feel or that you want is true because you feel it or you want it. And so, I mean, to project and to work and to live in uncertainty, science gives windows of uncertainty, gives a picture of what may or may not be possible. And considering that science has no value and rationality has no value, maybe the worst nightmare if we think about how to behave in the future or the future of our planet.
Well, I think so. There is a book called Science Under Siege that was written about 10 years ago in America, and it talked about the ways in which young kids who graduate from a university who have PhDs or master's degrees, and they go out into the field and they become employed by these government agencies in America, and they have these great ideas and they've done all these great papers and all this research, and they bring this great information to the agencies that they're working with, the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, the National Park Service, the Bureau of Land Management, all of those agencies that are very important for maintaining the wild lands that we still have left in America, and we still have a lot of them. And it talks about the ways in which they're undermined, all of their values are undermined, and they're very quickly they leave these agencies and they're left to these administrators who know nothing about the natural world and who care nothing about the value of the land and how it really impacts humans who want to engage with it. I know for myself, in the National Park Service, I introduced in the late 90s the idea of natural soundscapes becoming a resource for the national parks, resource like land and animals and other things. The soundscapes also have value. And if the soundscape is protected, the creatures that actually make the noise and make the sounds and create this wonderful lyrical narrative of the natural world, if those are gone, then we know that a habitat is in trouble, like in our area, which I just described. Well, I introduced this idea of natural soundscapes and the natural soundscape program, where people would go out and where people would come to the national parks, and there would be rangers who were educational rangers who would teach them about soundscapes so that they could go out and record, like they take pictures. Well, it didn't take long before, in 2004, there were a couple of politicians in the House of Representatives, one from Alaska and one from California, who threatened the National Park Service with defunding it by saying that if they didn't change the term soundscape, which was too left-wing for them, soundscape, okay, like landscape or seascape, soundscape was too radical. If they didn't change it, they were going to defund the whole program in the National Park Service. So they changed the term from soundscape to sound, and now they have the natural sound program, which is doing nothing for visitors at this point. And it's remarkable how these things are changing. And these are two individuals, by the way, who who are in the House of Representatives who completely dismiss science as being real. I mean, here's all this information on global warming, and we have people who are in positions of high power, including the president-elect of the United States, who says that global warming is a hoax. I mean, I'm appalled at that. And there are people who just believe this. They believe this information. Why? Because they saw it on the internet.
Yes, and he's saying, you know, if I remember well, that when the question is asked, how do you know it? He says, everybody knows it.
Right? Sure. Yeah, everybody knows it.
So it's a new, it's a new kind of science.
a big sigh. Okay.
It's strange. I was thinking about remembering, you know, your women singing.
The bayaka.
In the forest.
Yeah.
Which is like a mirror image of Rhapsody in Blue, where you have the siren in the human music, right?
Absolutely.
Or what Murray Schafer does in cities like Vancouver, which is also very, very strange and moving. And I wanted to know what you think about where he's registering sirens, klaxons, trains, cormorants, other birds, and all is mixed in a hybrid soundscape, part machines, part human, part animal. So is this something also that, you know, that we should listen to allow nature to be part of our artificial human cities?
Yeah, sure. And one of the things that he did when he introduced the term soundscape, the paysage sonore, is something that's very recent in our lexicon. He wrote about this in 1977 in his book called Tuning of the World.
Which is a wonderful title. Right?
Yeah, it's a...
Tuning the World.
Yeah,
Accorder le monde. Accorder les sons du monde.
Well, he's a composer, as well as a great naturalist. And what he did was, he introduced this idea that you're talking about when he went into Vancouver and recorded all the sounds and tried to identify the origins. But what he didn't do with that, which I tried to address, was he didn't name the sources of sound and define them. So I took the soundscape, which is all the sound that reaches the human ear from any source. I took the soundscape and divided it into three components. These are origins of sound. The first of these components is called the geophony, geo from the Greek meaning earth, and phone meaning sound. And I combined those two, the prefix and the suffix, to create the idea and the concept of the wild sounds that exist in a wild habitat, like wind in the trees, water in the stream, waves at the ocean shore. The geophony is non-biological natural sound. And then we came up with the term biophony, biophony meaning living organisms, the sounds of living organisms, because it's very important to make the distinction between what geophony is, which were the first sounds ever heard on Earth, but there were no organisms to hear them until they evolved, of course. And then they found their own niches and ways to be heard and express their voices expressed in the natural world. So the biophony addressed the ways in which living organisms in a given habitat collectively express themselves. And finally, there's the anthropophony. Like in anthropology, it's the study of human development. Anthropophony is the sounds that humans generate. And basically, there are two subcategories to that. The first of those is the controlled sound, like language and music and theater. And the second of those is chaotic or incoherent sound that we call noise. And it's really important to make the distinction between the two. And the noise is mostly the electromechanical devices that create all the distraction and noise around us. These are really important to consider because the anthropophony affects the biophony in profound ways. If you are in a rainforest, for instance, like I've been in the Amazon, and a jet plane flies very low over the forest, the problem is that the biophony is distracted, and the voices of these animals are masked, and they can't hear themselves, and they can't express themselves, so their voices drop out. And sometimes that has an impact when a creature becomes silent or the rhythm of its voice is upset by human noise. It allows predation to take place, so a predator will come in and pick off that particular insect. So it has so everything that we do, all of our presence has a direct impact on that environment and the soundscape. And the soundscape is the surest way to test and evaluate the health of that habitat.
Yes, and you
I'm glad we changed the subject, by the way.
And you did. The funny part is also, it's what we don't hear, right? The noise in the ocean,
yeah,
which is getting bigger and bigger with motors, with sonars, and which don't disturb us, but which disturbs whales and
yeah, sure.
So it's one thing. The other thing which you show also is suprasonic sounds, right? Like bats that we can't hear, and that you can.
We can manipulate the sound.
Manipulate. You don't hear it as the bats hear it or other animals, no. but we hear them.
Yeah.
And so in the soundscapes, there are also sounds that we don't hear, which is nice. And it's like, you know, it reminds me always about ultraviolet light, which birds can see, which bees can see, which fish can see, and which we don't see. And that we can reconstitute, which means we can imagine how a bird or a bee sees a flower that we see in red or in blue, and we know it's seen in another color. But in fact, we don't know what impression this color is doing, like the ultrasound, right? So it's
infrasound.
Or infrasound for the whales or other. So it shows us also that this fullness that we have, this sensation of fullness when we look, when we see, or when we hear, which is extraordinary, is only a small part of reality. But it's only a small part of reality that other living beings, that other animals can perceive. So it's like a mosaic or a kaleidoscope. And the two things which are complementary, it's this impression of fullness when we close the eyes and we hear, and also this impression of what escapes us and what is occurring, and which science can not reveal as we cannot feel it, but we can know it exists and see how it looks like.
Absolutely. And because this is such a new field, soundscape ecology is only like 10 years old, because this is such a new field, we're just discovering the ways in which organisms produce sound. For instance, we have recordings of viruses. I have 200 different species of fish vocalizing. I have ants singing.
You have plants.
I've got plants. I've got corn growing. It's actually the sound of corn growing as the stalk telescopes at night. In a hot August night, when the corn is in the field at night, it grows maybe 5 centimeters. It can spring, and it's fantastic to see that or to hear that. I've got a tree singing. It's what's happening inside the tree is the cells in the xylem and the phloem in the trunk of the tree. At a certain time of year when there's no rain, the cells suck in osmotic pressure and they try to maintain osmotic pressure. And when they get too dry and the pressure is too great, the cells explode and die, and that forms the rings on the tree. But when the cells pop, they create this very high frequency sound that's maybe 2.5 octaves beyond the highest note that we can hear. And I noticed that one evening when I was recording bats in the forest, and, And I was near this particular species of tree. And as I got closer to the tree, the sound in my bat detector, which is an instrument which lowers the frequency of the bat so we can hear it. And as I got closer to the tree, there was this steady signal. And I couldn't understand where that signal was coming from, but I drilled a tiny hole in the side of the tree and inserted a hydrophone, which is a little bit smaller than the head of this light. And I inserted the hydrophone in the tree and got a sound, which is a rhythmic sound, which goes like very rapidly when I slowed up that sound because it was 70 kilohertz, 2.5 octaves beyond what we hear. So I slowed it up by a factor of 7 and got this rhythmic sound of the cells popping in this tree. And we did it with a hydrophone. So what we have now is the capacity to be able to bring the very high frequency down to a level where we can actually hear it, and the very low frequencies up to a level where we can actually hear it. And what's really interesting about it is that the whales, the dolphins and the large whales, are the animals that have the highest range of sound, the lowest range being around 5 cycles per second of sound, 5 hertz, if you can imagine that. And the blind Ganges dolphin goes up as high as 356 kilohertz. We are able to hear between 20 hertz and 20 kilohertz. So we've got a lot of work to do to figure out what's going on and how this acoustic world can inform us.
And the high frequency, the dolphin echolocate, right? Like
yeah.
bats.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's also something which is very troubling because they see with the sound that they emit coming back.
And they get a very clear image.
It's a real soundscape.
Yeah.
They're constantly creating a soundscape.
Yeah, the world around them. Yeah, it's really neat how that works.
The nice part when you were speaking about the cone, you know, it's funny because it's or making it slower, the movement of plants that Darwin studied was shown with filming and then going in rapid motion. And then you can see that the plants move a lot.
Yeah.
And it's a little bit what you are doing with the sounds, right?
I think so.
Slowing it or
well, we
want
to hear it. Now we can bring it into focus in a human range, in a human way, that we were never able to do before with all of these instruments that we have and the software that we have now. And it's one way to really capture a sense of what's out there in the natural world. I talk about soundscapes and the biophony as being a narrative of place. And if you think about it in that way, this idea is like the Library of Alexandria. I don't know how many of you know about the Library of Alexandria, but it was an ancient library that contained all of the knowledge of the world. And at some point, mythologically, it was destroyed, and that knowledge somehow disappeared. But this is the knowledge of the world of living organisms. And to the extent that we help and try to preserve that, we're going to be a lot healthier as a culture. There's a fellow, speaking of that, there's a fellow by the name of Paul Shepard who died, who's an ecologist and a naturalist, who died in 1996. And he was also an American philosopher, an eco-philosopher. And he spoke about our connection to the natural world. And he says, the further we draw away from the natural world as a culture, the more pathological we become. And if you don't believe that, I mean, just watch the evening news, and you'll see. You'll see.
But it's interesting what you say, because there are recent papers, recent studies indicating that in cities, in different parts of the world, one of the most recent is in Canada, depending on the number of trees on the streets, the percentage of people being ill in these surroundings is lower. And there are other studies with parks, which means surroundings of parks in cities, people, physiological disorders is reduced statistically. And depressive or mood disorders is reduced. So there is something which is, I mean, the definition since 70 years by the World Health Organization of health is not only the absence of disease or handicap, it's a feeling of well-being,
yeah.
Physical, psychological, and social. And so if our connection with nature makes us feel well, I mean, it gives us health in a deep sense.
Well, in my own case, I have a terrible case of ADHD. I've suffered this malady since I was a kid, which means I can't concentrate on things for long periods of time. And I have a lot of anxiety and trouble that I've tried to overcome most of my life. And it wasn't, you know, and medication did nothing for me. And it wasn't until I got out into the natural world and I was working in offices and recording studios. You're talking a little bit about music. Thank you. You didn't pursue that.
I wanted you to speak about it.
I wasn't going to say anything. But anyway, it wasn't until I got out into the natural world and began to spend a lot of time there that I began to feel better, that I began to feel healthier, that I was able to focus on things, that I was able to temper the dyslexia and the terrible anxiety that I felt. And it was really this connection with the animal world that made that much of a difference to me. I know that when I grew up in the American Midwest, I grew up in a family that was terribly animal averse, meaning they hated animals and I could never have a pet as a young child. Well, that had, and it made me afraid of the natural world in ways that I can't even begin to describe. But when I finally, little by little, went out into the field and began to record and work further apart from cities and areas where there are a lot of people around, I began to feel better. And that was the reason that I actually began doing it. It wasn't science, it wasn't to try to create art with it. I had no idea that this would happen, that we'd bring it to this point in my life. But one of the things that you also mentioned about sound or nature making us feel better, one of the things that also happens is that the anthropophony and human endeavor makes us feel stressed. If you take a look at the medication that's being prescribed to populations in cities like New York and Chicago and Los Angeles, because of noise that's introduced in our environment, it's really pretty extraordinary. And I imagine it's not very much different here or in London. And it's something that we really have to consider, how we're modifying and mediating our acoustic environment as well as the rest of the natural environment around us.
There is something which we never discussed, I think, which I wanted to ask you or to you know, when biophony or anthropophony, if we take the sound of a group of person of, you know, in people speaking in a room, we get voices. We can identify whether it's man or we don't listen to the words. And so it's fantastic because we have the wolves, we have the insects. But did you what an animal is saying to another animal, even to an animal of the other species, what mothers and fathers are saying to their youngs, is it something which interested you? There are a lot of studies now about a deep communication, even mother bird speaking to their infant in the egg and learning, teaching something. By the way, it makes me always think what, I mean, this impression, you know, this fullness of your soundscape makes me remind that the first experience that we have during 9 months in the womb of our mother is sounds. Mm. And it's natural sounds. It's a heartbeat. It's the voices, and it's the first echoes that we have from the outside world. We begin to see very late after we are born, So it's also something which brings us back to our first experience, even if infantile amnesia erases it, or at least erases it consciously, because there are studies, recent studies showing that children remember something about the language, and in particular it's Chinese, so it's a language where the tonality has important. A meaning, remember it when they become 6, 7 years old.
Yeah.
If you look at their brain activity when they listen to different sounds, they don't know that they remember, but their brain shows that they don't respond to the language, and they were not with their mother since their birth. They were adopted by people which didn't speak this language. So there is something which is imprinted,
yeah,
even if it's unconscious. And I think it's, you know, it might be one of the reasons why it's so surprising. Maybe why it's, you know, why it's not so clear,
yeah,
than when we see, we have the impression that everything is clear. When we listen, it's like we are asking a question. We are a little bit dreaming, we are imagining.
There are two things there. First of all, hearing is physical. We have to have some kind of, there's something that moves physically within us when we hear a sound. Visual is not physical in the same way. The other thing is that
The other difference is we cannot close our ears.
We can't close our ears. That's
exactly
right.
We close our eyes constantly.
Yeah,
right?
Sound is always present in our lives. The other thing is that I wanted to point out was that because you were mentioning China and a sonic language, the other thing I wanted to point out that in China, over 50% of the people in China have perfect pitch. In Western culture, only 3% of the people have perfect pitch. And the reason for that is that, again, the language is tonal, and because it's tonal, you have to understand subtle shifts in the ways in which language is expressed. And so it's really important. I was fascinated when I went to China to realize that so many people could sing for me an A440, which is a tone in the on the piano that orchestras tune to. I had no idea that that was possible, but almost everybody I met in China could actually sing that tone.
It's funny, and it's forgotten because every child can learn any language, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So
yeah,
it's forgotten, yeah, yeah, like 6 months of or 1 year. it's a period where we adapt to our language, and where, for example, a Japanese child doesn't make the difference between L and R. So it's what you are saying is that Chinese and other languages, which are tonal, learn to sing in the same way that they learn to speak, right? They learn music.
Yeah.
But coming back to the you know, to what animals are saying, I mean, at least expressing emotions, communicating, often interfering one with the other, with alarm cries,
sure,
right? When that can go from one species to the other. Is it something that you have tried to approach, or is it the global sound that is your essential interest?
Well, what we haven't realized until now is there's more to animal language than defining territory or sexual discrimination one gender from another, making your presence felt in a given habitat. And this is kind of the old 100-year-old model of what sound represents. Well, when I began to do this work in 1968, I took a different approach. My idea was to record whole soundscapes and examine the world holistically, because that's where the information comes from. And if we, it's a little like if you don't do that, What's happened is that many institutions, like Cornell University, for instance, have modeled all of their system on the idea that that we have to record one bird at a time, or one frog at a time, or one mammal at a time, and store all of these individual species out of context. Well, if you decontextualize it, it's a little like trying to understand the magnificence of Beethoven's Fifth Symphony by abstracting the sound of one violin player out of the context of the orchestra and hearing just that one part. And that's what we've been doing with the natural world. Well, when I started in 1968, I decided to do this more holistically. And I used instrumentation, recorders, microphones that were going to give me a result that expressed that whole idea a little more cogently. And one of the things that I found here is, again, I was talking about this narrative of place a few minutes ago, but what's important about that is that there's more information in the contextual soundscape, the biophony. There's more information in that spectrum that needs to be explored. And I welcome any of you in this audience who's younger than me to get out into the field and actually begin to do this kind of work, because we need to find out what that information is. And speaking of a night of uncertainty, we need to do it fairly quickly, because these habitats are disappearing fairly fast. And I would love to see some way to mitigate that if we can. Yeah. So,
because just to finish up what you said, because it's a night of uncertainty, one of the big uncertainties that which begins to be explored is whether animal language is just emotional music, or if it's an opera, if it's music with words, which means whether there is meaning, also semantic value in the language. And
there may be, and
there are examples in some monkeys, in other animals,
dolphins,
showing that there is
birds,
that there is some lexic, some vocabulary, some semantic. And the question is, are these exceptions? And usually when something unexpected or unwished is happening in the animal world, the first answer is it doesn't exist. If it looks too close to a human behavior, it doesn't exist. The second one is it's an exception.
Yeah.
And usually the third one is it's a general property. It's an example of a general property.
Yeah.
So I think this, you know, trying in the soundscapes, in the picture, in the global relationship that you record, to go maybe one day not only about emotional feelings, but about something which is a little bit like a language with sense, would be something fascinating. As you said,
I think it's
getting
there.
Right. I getting the global picture is essential. Because even when speaking, I was thinking, fairy wren, superb fairy wren, speak to their children, as I said. But they speak to their children so that the little bird in the egg can learn a password, which will show to the mother that it's not a cuckoo. But in fact, the mother, studies have shown that the mother teaches all the more, says the song, the password, all the more, that there are cuckoo females singing nearby.
Yeah.
So the whole picture is, you can listen to this dialogue, but if you know when it's triggered or when it's enhanced, you have the answer. So I think it's going from the global soundscape to something which will become in the future more and more fine and refined and surprising.
Absolutely, absolutely. And just kind of think about this in a cultural way, the science. one of the things that we found with the natural soundscapes is that, I mean, people keep questioning me about the music idea and the music connection, because after all, we were supposed to have learned music in the conservatory, we were supposed to learn music in university and so on. We didn't. We learned it from the animals. And we learned rhythm by watching the ways in which chimpanzees and mountain gorillas beat out rhythms on these wings of ficus trees, the blades that come out that support the tree. We learned melody from birds. We learned rhythm from frogs. We learned the ways in which all of the sounds in the forest coalesce into a cohesive pattern, like you're seeing here in these spectrograms. So we learned orchestration by doing that. We learned the ways in which to compose vocalizations and choruses, because that's the way we did in the beginning. We just sang, and we were mimics. And we all are mimics, and that's how we learned our music. So it's really important to make those connections now and to begin to explore the ideas that this narrative is beginning to express. And all we have to do is find a key to decipher what's being expressed there, because we've never bothered to listen to it before. And we better do it before it's too late. Yeah.
Thank you.
So I think so. Bravo. So maybe we take some questions from the audience.
I think so.
Okay. I have to put this on because if it's in French, I won't hear. Voilà. Okay. I take questions.
Des questions.
We take questions.
Des réponses, des suggestions, des remarques. Okay. Oui.
Bonjour, c'était avant tout pour dire merci. Merci pour les balades du samedi matin sur les épaules de Darwin et autres, depuis des nombreuses années sur cette magnifique différence de France Inter. Merci beaucoup à vous. Juste un témoignage rapidement. Ça fait des années. Ah oui, je voulais juste vous dire, en Provence, l'été, les oiseaux, on ne les entend pas non plus, on ne les voit pas non plus, on a seulement les cigales. C'est la même chose quand vous disiez en Californie la chaleur. Nous, on connaît ça tous les étés. Bon. Ils reviennent. Nous, les oiseaux, ils reviennent. Pour le moment, ça va. C'est les abeilles qui ont des problèmes, mais les oiseaux, ils reviennent. Et juste témoigner, ça fait des années et des années que je pratique des massages avec le son des baleines. C'est une pure merveille d'harmonisation de la personne qui est massée et de la personne qui masse. Donc là, je corrobore ce que vous avez dit sur l'équilibre mental, cérébral, énergétique de l'être humain grâce aux fréquences d'orchestre des animaux. Voilà, c'était juste pour célébrer votre travail. Merci.
Thank you. That was a very nice comment. What we're finding is that in our area, Northern California, spring is occurring a couple of weeks earlier than it did 20 years ago. And it's getting incrementally longer in period, the spring season, which is having a profound effect on the migrating birds migrating through our area. Because the birds that normally expected to land and find vegetation and food and resting areas are not finding what they were looking for, what they would normally find on these flyways. So things are changing all over the place. We're having problems with bees as well in our area. A lot of bees are disappearing in large numbers, and we need those to pollinate the plants in the area. We live in wine country, so that's very important to have a healthy population of bees. But things are changing very rapidly, and maybe sometimes these changes are going to be okay, but sometimes not, and we don't know what the implications are. Speaking of the night of uncertainty, we just don't know at this point. Question?
And it's If I can add something, we are speaking about climate change, right?
Yeah.
But there is also what is causing climate change, which means fuel consumption, oil consumption. And this, independently of climate change, is killing a lot of people. World Health Organization says that 3.5 million people die each year just from the pollution of the air, more than 40,000 in France. So it's not only changing the paradox is that it's not only profoundly affecting nature, it's also profoundly making us sick and killing us before the climate change can have or may have an effect by itself. And I think that it's also what is killing us might not also be very good for the living world. So it's really a very big problem. I wanted to ask, je voulais vous demander, c'est les chants de baleine à bosse. c'est les plus beaux, voilà.
Hello. First of all, I would like to thank both of you for being here. And I had a question for you, Bernie.
Yes.
Because I'm a student in sound, and I would like to know which kind of mics do you use when you record natural habitats, usually, if you have any preferences.
Good grief, we're getting serious now.
Okay.
The kinds of microphones I use typically are Sennheiser microphones, and I use a combination of a cardioid microphone, which is a heart-shaped pattern, and a figure-eight pattern in what's called an MS system, mid-side. And what happens is that type of recording gives you many advantages in post-production, meaning after I record, when I go back to listen to this material, and I want to either evaluate it from a scientific perspective or actually create something aesthetic out of it. So it gives you many different options from one recording. And that's pretty much what I use. And I also use a very small digital recorder called a Sound Devices 722 or 744. Yeah. You're welcome. Oh, come on. Yes. Someone.
Bonsoir. Merci beaucoup pour cette très intéressante discussion. Je voulais revenir sur la notion de paysage sonore et en fait, ce paysage sonore qu'on peut observer, qu'on peut entendre grâce aussi au fait qu'au-delà de notre capacité d'humain, de notre perception d'humain, on a des instruments qui permettent d'enregistrer les infrasons, les ultrasons. Le résultat est qu'on voit un paysage sonore que, en fait, nous ne percevons pas, mais que les animaux eux-mêmes qui produisent ce paysage sonore ne percevront pas dans leur intégralité, puisque on sait que, en fonction de si on est une grenouille, un oiseau, un insecte, chacun a sa réception particulière. Donc, en fait, on a le pouvoir, nous, de voir ce paysage sonore. C'est un pouvoir extraordinaire qui nous permet de voir le monde. Mais ce paysage sonore, il est virtuel, et il est au moins virtuel pour la plupart des organismes qui l'habitent, puisque, je ne sais pas, un animal qui est capable d'entendre dans des fréquences entre 1 kHz et 5 kHz ne va pas percevoir ce qui se passe au-dessus et inversement. Et donc, je trouve que c'est philosophiquement et poétiquement et aussi terrifiant de pouvoir voir ce paysage sonore avant qu'il ne disparaisse, sachant que les animaux qui le composent, eux-mêmes, n'en perçoivent qu'une partie. C'était juste un commentaire et peut-être une question.
Thank you. That's why this is the night of uncertainty.
Si je peux vous dire quelque chose, je ne sais pas pourquoi c'est terrifiant. C'est extrêmement, enfin, je trouve ça extrêmement émouvant et extrêmement beau.
C'est terrifiant parce que ça risque de disparaître.
Voilà. Alors, dans ce sens, oui, tout à fait. Mais je veux dire le fait que, au fond, le fait que le tout soit plus que la somme des parties. et que, au fond, l'ensemble des réalités perçues par les êtres vivants est d'une richesse extraordinaire. C'est quelque chose d'émouvant. Maintenant, il y a aussi quelque chose d'important. De la même façon que les couleurs, de la même façon que les odeurs, dont l'essentiel, d'ailleurs, nous ne le percevons pas, et nous n'avons pas, pour l'instant, de odorscape. Hein, on a des landscapes, on a des soundscapes, on n'a pas d'odorscape. Or, la richesse des odeurs, des molécules qui sont émises et qui renseignent sur la présence est tout à fait extraordinaire. Ce qui est extraordinaire dans les odeurs, c'est que, contrairement à ce que nous révèlent la vision et l'audition, cela nous parle de ce qui n'est plus là. On peut sentir la présence d'un animal ou d'une plante il y a 10 minutes. On ne peut pas entendre ce que disait un animal il y a 10 minutes. On ne peut pas voir un animal 10 minutes après. Donc il y a d'autres mondes, j'allais dire, qui restent à explorer. Mais ce que je voulais dire, c'est que ça intervient dans l'évolution même du vivant. Et donc, pouvoir ne pas être détecté par un prédateur dont la fréquence qu'il entend a une limite et pouvoir émettre dans une fréquence qui est inférieure ou supérieure fait partie de ce qu'on appelle la course de la reine rouge, hein, des attaques, des contre-attaques et des contre-attaques. Donc ça a joué un rôle. Ce n'est pas simplement quelque chose qui existe, c'est quelque chose qui est activement mis en marche et mis en route et qui évolue de manière perpétuelle. Et il y a, sur les luttes entre les chauves-souris, par exemple, et les insectes qu'elles poursuivent, de très belles facettes de ce type, hein, des faux ultrasons émis par la proie pour que la chauve-souris croie qu'elle a entendu ou vu quelque chose qui n'existe pas, ou au contraire, le fait de... Donc c'est vraiment un monde en plus mouvant. Et quand vous dites qu'il disparaît, je dirais, de toute façon, même s'il y a une préservation de la nature, il disparaît parce qu'il évolue. Hein? Et donc, nous ne pouvons pas, c'est comme les langues. On ne peut maintenir que la capacité d'évoluer, de faire émerger la nouveauté, de se renouveler du vivant. On ne peut pas, sauf dans nos mémoires, dans nos archives, maintenir un état du vivant à un moment donné. Et ce que disait d'ailleurs Bernie Krause, avant que les premiers organes auditifs, qui sont très variés, les insectes n'écoutent pas, n'entendent pas de la même façon que les mammifères ou les oiseaux, avant que les premières capacités de percevoir des sons n'émergent, eh bien, il n'y avait pas de perception du son dans le monde vivant. Et donc, si on avait arrêté la photo à ce moment-là, les soundscapes n'existeraient pas, en tout cas la biophonie n'existerait pas. Et donc, la biophonie de demain sera différente. Et ça fait partie aussi de ce qu'il y a à la fois de merveilleux et de nostalgique dans le fait que ce que nous percevons, même si ce qu'on espère tous, il n'y a pas de disparition ou de destruction de la capacité du monde vivant à se renouveler, eh bien c'est éphémère, c'est temporaire. Une écrivaine américaine, Octavia Butler, disait que la seule permanence, c'est le changement. C'est ça l'évolution du monde vivant.
Yeah. C'est ça.
J'ai juste une petite question un peu concrète. Comment on enregistre un virus et à quoi ça sert pour la recherche médicale concrètement?
Well, first of all, we record it with a very small microphone. how do you record a virus? You isolate the virus in a container, and then you're able to. What happened in this particular case? This was a study done at Cambridge University, and what happened was when the virus was releasing itself from a cell, it was a herpes virus. When it was releasing itself from a cell, it gives off a certain kind of signature impulse, and in regard to your second part, the second part of your question, what is it used for? Well, if we can find what the signature is of a particular type of virus, which is not a living organism, organism, by the way, but if we can find out what the signature is of that virus, we can then introduce a negative signature of the same kind and potentially target that virus and kill it. And that's the idea of the kind of research that we're doing now on viruses. So what you get is you get a plus one with the signature of that virus, and then introduce a minus one, which is exactly the same, which is exactly a mirror image of that. And you can cause a phase, what's called a phase cancellation. And that phase cancellation just cancels the life of that organism. We can do that. I mean, it can happen to humans too. There is a way to actually phase cancel a person's life, as some strobe lights have indicated. So I hope that answers your question.
Mr. Krauss, thank you so much for being here and for enlightening us about the soundscapes.
Thank you.
I have a question about the distance that sound, animal sound, can travel. Because I'm very interested in the natural world and in animal life and animal protection. And every day for 6 months of the year at Taiji in Japan, dolphins and pilot whales are rounded up. Yeah. Pods are pursued, rounded up, and brought back into Taiji Bay and slaughtered.
That's right.
And this also happens in the Faroe Islands, as you know. So my question is, and the question of all these people who follow these massacres every day online, if sound travels, and if dolphins and pilot whales and other animals use echolocation, why can they not, or can they, communicate their distress and the fact that they're being predated upon by humans? Can they communicate this to other pods, in the sea? I mean, how far does sound travel, really? Or have you determined this?
Roger Payne, who studied humpback whales in the U.S., made a determination at one point that some of the lower frequency signals can probably travel around the Earth two or three times if unimpeded by land mass and human noise. That means the cavitation of the propellers that these large vessels are putting out, and also signals that the navies of the world are introducing into the marine environment. So how far can sound travel underwater? In some cases, a very long way. And blue whales, which vocalize about two octaves below what we can hear at 20 hertz, their signals can travel. They've been picked up at 300 miles, which is almost 500 kilometers. So sound can travel very far. The sounds that dolphins typically reproduce don't travel all that far, maybe a few hundred meters at best. But I know that when dolphins do echolocation, I've been in the water with them, when they're doing echolocation and scanning your body, you can actually feel the impulse of the scan through your entire body. It's very unusual, and it's kind of scary at first when you feel this thing penetrating you completely through your body. Typically the dolphin sounds don't travel very far. The blind Ganges dolphin that I was mentioning before that has this very high frequency thing, probably not more than 20 meters. So it's not too far. So it all depends on the frequency that the animal is vocalizing in. Humpbacks tend to be social animals, and killer whales tend to be social animals, so they gather together. The reason that dolphins in Taiji and around that area are not able to communicate one pod to the next, we think, is because why there's so much noise, and they're banging on these long metal pipes to herd them into these little areas. I forgot what they're called, but yeah. So it's really impossible for them to escape when they're banging on these oikomi pipes, is what they call them. And so that's a whole terrible tragedy in itself. But also the Japanese are hunting whales in the Antarctic, as are a number of other nations. And I think we have to address a lot of that. Another question? I don't have control over it, I'm sorry.
By the way, which we didn't mention, your question about whales and whales being slaughtered reminded me that and you have it probably in a lot of your soundscapes, right? It's the fact that there is a cultural transmission of variation in the sounds. Darwin was speaking about dialects from birds because he saw that one species of birds, which was coming from Austria, did not sync with the same dialect, he was saying, that the same species in England. But whales, humpback whales, have songs which evolve during the year, so the song change, and they exchange songs between colonies. And nobody knows whether it's because they travel very fast or it's also because they cross one each other from time to time. And so after 1 year, 1 year and a half, a colony can take the song of another colony and lose its own song. So a lot of animals which have cultural transmission, which have been studied for for tools, which are more and more studied, the cultural invention and transmission of language, of voices, is much less studied besides exception. And so your soundscape might be full over time maybe, or from place to place, of new forms of vocal invention transmissions.
Well, certainly with humpback whales, that's true. Yeah. And also with killer whales. Each killer whale pod has its own accent, if you will. It's and it's extraordinary to hear the differences between all of these pods of whales, these groups of whales. And it's something that, you know, I certainly have in my library. It's wonderful to hear. Question. Yes.
Yes. À propos du struggle for life, on a toujours dit que dans les forêts, les arbres luttaient pour la lumière. Et en même temps, ce struggle for life était une philosophie où cette compétition, elle était appliquée aux hommes, aux animaux. Et dans l'enfance, j'entendais toujours dire, ils se dévorent entre eux. C'est ça la loi. Et de la nature. Et aujourd'hui, quelqu'un vient déranger cette philosophie de l'agression permanente ou de la guerre pour une image de coexistence, d'équilibre. Et pour moi, c'est une révolution. Et ça, philosophiquement, dans nos cultures occidentales, où celui qui gagne, c'est celui qui fait la compète économique aujourd'hui, avant plutôt guerrière. Et je vois qu'on peut projeter cette philosophie dans beaucoup de domaines. Par exemple, les arbres dans la forêt, vus par quelques botanistes, expliquent qu'il n'y a pas forcément une énorme compétition, mais que chacun a des niches et peut coexister. Même si, par exemple, chez les animaux, ils se mangent les uns les autres. Mais bon, je pense qu'on peut considérer le temps de paix entre les différentes espèces, plutôt que de considérer le temps d'agression. Je ne sais pas. Qu'est-ce que vous... Comment vous ressentez cette approche?
Je pense... Alors, si je peux vous dire, je pense que l'idée de la struggle for life est une... L'acception qu'on a fait du terme est totalement contradictoire, éloignée de celle que Darwin avait empruntée. Il y a un très beau texte de Huxley, qui était un des collègues et un des défenseurs de Darwin, qui explique que le struggle for life, ce n'est pas le combat des gladiateurs, tel que c'est dans la société anglaise à l'époque de Darwin, traduit. C'est pas du tout ça. Darwin explique dans un passage de l'Origine des espèces que le struggle for life, c'est l'ensemble des éléments qui permet à un être vivant de survivre. Ça ne veut pas dire qu'il se bat contre un autre être vivant. Et il donne un exemple d'une graine dont le struggle for life est de s'accrocher de telle manière à ce qu'elle soit tombée. Elle a réussi son struggle for life si par hasard elle est tombée sur un sol où elle peut pousser. Donc cette idée du combat, de la compétition, etc., bien sûr que ça fait partie de la nature. Et il y a eu deux visions un peu caricaturale. Il y a eu la vision du combat permanent. Et puis il y a eu la vision de Kropotkin qui est l'inverse, qui est la partie de Darwin, qui est la coopération. Un des thèmes essentiels de la théorie de Darwin, c'est la coopération qui, dit-il, émerge dans les relations entre une mère et son petit. Il n'y a pas de petit dans la plupart des espèces vivantes qui survit si des adultes ne s'en sont pas occupés. Et donc il y a pour lui le creuset d'une possibilité de coopération avec d'autres qui ne sont pas des petits. Donc il y a à la fois des combats, des luttes, de la coopération, de l'empathie, de la sympathie. Et les deux coexistent. Et donc je pense qu'une vision qui est une vision guerrière de la nature est une vision partielle et caricaturale. Mais une vision qui est une vision à la Rousseau d'une nature dans laquelle on peut se promener, côtoyer un tigre, sortir vivant, ne pas attraper le paludisme, est aussi une vision fausse. Donc la complexité de l'évolution du vivant, si on ne prend pas en compte les humains, c'est un mélange, une articulation de douceur et de dureté, de tendresse et de terreur. Et c'est ça qui forme le monde vivant. Hein, mais en tout cas, ce struggle for life, c'est pas dans l'acception profonde, c'est pas le struggle contre un autre. Hein, c'est ce qui fait qu'un être vivant réussit ou pas à survivre et à avoir des descendants.
Yeah, I'd like to add one more thing to that, and that is that Ken Norris, with whom I studied and worked, he was the head of environmental studies at University of California in Santa Cruz, and Ken Norris was working for most of his life with dolphins, and he came up with the concept of animal altruism. And there are plenty of examples of animal altruism as well. So not only is there competition and cooperation, but there's also altruism. There's ways in which the animals actually reach out. I've seen this happen in gorilla groups, in chimpanzees with bonobos. And I've also seen it with whales. There's a certain attitude toward other members of the species that's helpful instead of competitive, that isn't even a mother and child relationship. So there are other things that we haven't very much explored in the natural world that we just need to begin to think of other ways that that we can look at that.
The instinct of sympathy, which because the word empathy didn't exist at this time, that Darwin insisted on, is altruism. Right, it's helping the other even at the expense of what. And what, when he was speaking about the importance, which Frans de Waal today has taken again, about the importance of the mother-child relationship, it's not because it's the only situation in which there is empathy, sympathy, and altruism. It's because when it's developed, it could be exerted to others.
That's right.
So chimpanzees, for example, will adopt an orphan. Yep. And even a male chimpanzee and spend years educating this world. So you have really both in nature. The Frans de Waal say that humans. Frans de Waal dit que les êtres humains sont des primates bipolaires. Pourquoi? Parce que nos deux cousins les plus proches d'un point de vue généalogique sont les chimpanzés et les bonobos. Les chimpanzés sont les seuls animaux qu'on connaisse qui font la guerre à des animaux de la même espèce. Et donc, il y a des chimpanzés qui, lorsqu'ils croisent un groupe de chimpanzés étrangers, en général moins nombreux parce qu'ils ne sont pas très courageux, ils peuvent les tuer sur leur passage sans aucune raison que nous puissions détecter. Et ils ont des expéditions parfois contre une colonie qui habite à quelques kilomètres et où ils vont tuer les membres. Donc c'est quelque chose de malheureusement très humain qui nous est proche, c'est-à-dire au fond tuer des membres de la même espèce sans raison vitale évidente. Et puis les bonobos, c'est l'inverse. Quand des bonobos, qui sont des sociétés matriarcales, où comme vous le savez, les jeux et l'affection sexuelle fait partie des interactions. quand des groupes de bonobos rencontrent un groupe de bonobos étrangers, eh bien, ils jouent avec eux. Ils ne les tuent pas, ils ne les agressent pas. Donc, deux exemples de comportements majoritaires dans deux espèces qui nous sont les plus proches et qui nous disent que, qui nous renvoient l'image du fait que nous avons les deux potentialités en nous. Nous sommes capables à la fois d'accueil, d'ouverture, d'empathie, et nous sommes malheureusement capables de rejet, ce qui se répand actuellement depuis quelques années dans le monde, de rejet, du refus de l'autre, d'exclusion, de discrimination et de violence. Et donc je crois que il faut essayer de faire en sorte que ce soit nos capacités les plus humaines, les plus ouvertes, les plus altruistes sur lesquelles nous insistions et que nous développions, et pas ces capacités que nous avons d'agressivité, de rejet, d'exclusion.
I think we'll take one more question. Yes?
It's not a question.
It's an answer.
Non, c'est une anecdote, si je peux me permettre. C'est une anecdote qui date d'une quarantaine d'années à peu près. J'avais un ami qui était un jeune chercheur physicien, mais qui travaillait dans un laboratoire de biologie et qui, plus exactement, d'hématologie. Et comme physicien, il avait été prié de concocter un petit bricolage pour observer les hématies, les globules rouges. Bon. Et il s'est passionné avec ça. Et un jour, il m'a dit, je les ai entendus chanter. Et ça l'avait beaucoup ému. Moi, j'ai trouvé ça très poétique. Et en même temps, à partir de ce moment-là, je sais pas, ça m'a ouvert des horizons sur toutes les sources sonores que chacun de nous pouvait être, y compris les animaux, enfin tous les êtres vivants. Et Bernie a parlé tout à l'heure des arbres, voilà. Et un petit peu plus tard, quelqu'un d'autre m'a dit, alors ça, je sais pas si c'est vrai, peut-être quelqu'un le confirmera, que les Chinois, pour dire comment tu t'appelles, ils disent comment tu sonnes. Voilà.
Thank you.
Merci.
I think we have to.
Oui, okay. Je crois qu'il faut qu'on s'arrête là. Merci.